this, but to bring them into the family and accept them, obviously with open arms, have talked to all those players. Some of them here on campus we'll get to in a minute, but really just an unusual time. I told Josh during the recruitment process when he was talking to me that I thought if you truly look at it the right way, this whole COVID process and everything that it brings needs to be used to our advantage. So that's what we kind of did. We tried to accept the way things were handled. We obviously couldn't go out on the road recruit, so everything was done through Zoom. Reached out to some contacts that, you know, currently existed within our myself as a head coach, but also some of the coaches I brought aboard, and gave us a couple signees that we see here today, and then also obviously some players that are entering our program through the transfer world, whether it be a grad transfer or a new COVID transfer, however you want to classify it. So really just the two new high school prospects that we entered in the family today, Josh McCray, running back out of Enterprise, Alabama. Kind of a neat story with Josh. So as soon as I took the job, I was contacted by his head coach, Jed Kennedy. Jed and I were back actually at the University of Wisconsin when I was there. I signed a player from his program, a guy by the name of Melvin Gordon, who was a player that played for me at Wisconsin. He was actually from the state of Wisconsin, but originally committed to Iowa. I stayed after him because I knew this kid was going to be a good player. We battled through it. Actually got him to decommit and eventually joined us as a freshman at the University of Wisconsin, went on to become a first-round draft pick, obviously a great NFL player, and represents everything that you want. So Jed called me right away, and right away, when he said, hey, I got another running back, I think you should take a peek at, he piqued my interest, learned a little bit about Josh, got on the phone with him immediately, got a chance to watch his film, got a chance to know him, made an offer, kind of battled the same kind of opponents, to be quite honest, early on, but a really talented player, very, very physical, very, very talented, got a lot of skills, not just at the running back position, but you'll see him catch the ball. I think there's some things he does in a kicking game, return game, just a very dynamic player, a guy we're very excited to have in the program, and kind of came about in a very unusual way, but he was the first kid to ever commit to me here at the University of Illinois in this class. So we'll always hold a special place in my heart for that, but really, really excited about what Josh brings. And then Dwayne Johnson, our version of The Rock, right? He came to us a little bit different, reached out to some of our coaches that I had hired here probably 2-3 weeks ago. Have been familiar with his high school, what he was all about. And really, you know, just again, saw him on film, really liked what he saw. We began to court him a little bit on phone calls, got Zoom with him and his mom one night, had a chance to show him our facilities. So all the things that we had here, and made an offer to him, and he accepted. Really, those are the only two new additions from the high school that we will. Both will play on different sides of the ball. Josh will be a running back, and obviously Dwayne will be an outside linebacker, inside linebacker, really get a feel for what he is once he's hitting on campus. But really excited about those two players, represent everything that we want in the way they've lived their life and the way that they play the game. A couple new transfers since I've came aboard. Obviously, the first one, Chase Hayden, guy I'm very familiar with, was a guy that we recruited at Arkansas. Highly sought after player out of high school, came in and played for me immediately at Arkansas. Comes from a tremendous family, comes from Memphis area. Dad played in the league for a while. Mom and dad went to Tennessee, so there was all that going on when we got him to come to Arkansas. When I was let go at Arkansas, he reached out to me immediately. And you know, certain players that I told during that recruiting process, just because I'm leaving you doesn't mean I'm leaving you. Stay in contact with me. Anything I can ever help. I actually recommended a lot of guys stay placed there at Arkansas. I was trying to help them have as much success as they could have after my departure, encouraged a lot of kids to stay there. But Chase just continued to stay in touch with me and actually transferred a year ago to a different university. Tried to help guide him and his parents through that process. And then lo and behold, when this opportunity came, I was kind of hoping he'd reach out, and he did it immediately. And I said, let's see what we got to do. So to get him here now on campus, he's been a great addition. I think he's got a lot of respect for the teammates. Hasn't played a down of football here yet, but has already made a good impression with a lot of people. CJ Hart is another transfer that comes from NC State, comes from the Fort Lauderdale area. Because of my relationship with Dave Dorn, I was actually talking to Coach Dorn about another issue in the world of college football, and he kind of asked if I was talking to anybody in the transfer portal, and I said, looking and exploring a lot of different people, but nobody specific. And he gave me CJ's name, got a chance to look at the film, learned a lot about him. We have some common acquaintances in the high schools that he's coming from or the background that he had. So we made an offer to him. He made a pledge to come join us, and he joined us here at the start of the school session. He'll be an inside-outside linebacker, very talented, very engaging, dynamic personality as well. And then latest addition, Prather Hudson has been able to join us. Prather comes to us from Georgia, started 53 straight games at Georgia on special teams, has been a very dynamic player for them. I love his story. He kind of shared my same story. Both of us started as walk-ons. He earned a scholarship fairly fast and played, you know, in college football playoffs on the biggest stage there is. And I think that's something that I'm really looking for is if we do bring in a transfer, especially grad transfers, that they bring in just something besides just talent. I wanted to bring in character, demeanor, a work ethic, and a standard of play. So as we begin to explore this transfer process, especially grad transfers, you know, if you can come from a background of championships, of winning football, big stage, college football playoffs, national championships, that's the stuff that intrigues us, as well as the ability to play the game. So those guys are here on campus, and we're still short. I purposely didn't sign any more extra bodies. If there was someone that we really felt was going to help us in a big way, we would have, of course, moved forward. But really just wanted to make sure we had a couple opportunities for anything that may happen here as we move forward. I go back to just learning from my past. I didn't get Russell Wilson. I didn't even have contact with Russ until after we were done with spring football when I brought him aboard. He didn't get into campus until June or July. And I just learned that sometimes things come after spring ball. So that's kind of where we're at. Obviously, signed a number of players before I got here. You're well aware of the names. I've got a couple guys on campus. Josh Jeske is an old lineman that's been here on campus and has been doing a nice job for us. Darius McConnell, a defensive lineman, has been working with our defensive line group and has touched down and does some good things. All these guys are in the building. Dylan Rossick is a guy that obviously storied history from his high school with Jake and everything. So I'm excited to get in the building with him. Ricky Washington, unfortunately, Doriel, he goes by Ricky. Ricky has actually had a surgery already. He actually had a pre-existing condition that actually injured his foot. So he's actually had surgery. He's going to miss spring ball, but he's been a good addition. Great personality. We like what he's done. And then Brody Weiscarver has joined us as well as an offensive lineman. So those five guys are here on campus, and then the remaining group will join us in the summer. So really, other than that, just kind of working through where we're at. Today, obviously, is the end of 21 football recruiting. We may add one on the end at the end, but that's yet to be determined. But it's really the now all focused onto the 22 family, right, onto the 2022 class. And has been a huge emphasis since I've got here to put it in the state. We made several outreaches early on the first week, 2 weeks on the job, and that's continued to build and grow. In the state here, we made offers to in-state prospects and really started from the northern tip to the southern tip and everywhere in between that we try to uncover any guys that, you know, could help us make offers, make opportunities to let them come here and be a part of what we're building. I think because now we're entering the start of high school football for these seniors, I think it was important or was diligent for us to hold back a few in case there's some guys that have changed from their junior year to reality of the last time they played football in front of people until where we are now. So we'll definitely make a thorough evaluation of every program in the state that's playing football. Anybody that coaches feel strongly about will definitely have a unique evaluation time for us here in the world of college football because that's going on, and we're excited about that opportunity as well.
All right, Coach, thank you. We'll open up for questions here. We've got Bob Osmussen lead off, Speedy Bob Osmussen, Robert Rosenthal on deck, and then Mark Pearson in the hole. Go ahead, Bob.
Okay, Coach, I've got a two-parter. Ask you to go back to when you first started coaching in college. How is recruiting drastically different than then? And tell me, how is it the same? What are the things you're doing now that you did back then? And, you know, how I was ignoring COVID, everything else, what's difference in the same?
Number one thing is right here, right? This phone. And I think about I started going on the road. I had this, it looked like a walkie talkie from, you know, old war movies where it was like right here. And I thought I was pretty live. I was on a sitting in the airport. I didn't even have it on, but I'm talking to it like I was big time, you know, because nobody else had cell phones. And now you got everything is through this phone, right? We do FaceTimes, we do Zooms, we do direct messaging, we do DMing, we do texting. And then you can literally be on the phone and a kid might say something and you'll Google up another player that he's talking about. I mean, it's a whole different world because of technology. It still is a people business. You know, I think about early on in my career, I distinctly remember I was heavily mentored by obviously Coach Fry, but I was really under the wing of a guy by the name of Bob Elliott, who was Bump Elliott's son, who God rest his soul, is no longer with us at this point. But Bobby was a young coach who helped me kind of learn the business. And I remember there was an article written about me because I'd signed a lot of players that had come in that recruiting class. Anthony Heron, who's now with the Big Ten Network, and you guys know from media, Ant was one of my first signees ever out of Bolingbrook High School. There was a group of players up in Minnesota. I signed three guys, a couple guys from Iowa that I was involved with. And there was this article that was written about Bielema's boys, right? The guys that Bielema had recruited. And I was mad because I didn't want to be known as a recruiter. I want to be known as a ball coach. And Bobby, I'll never forget it, basically said, listen, early in your career, you need to recruit and build a reputation. And then at some point when that football opportunity comes, you'll take full advantage of it. And I think that's what kind of guided me and my staff now. You know, got a couple guys on staff. I've got a couple of mentors, you know, and Coach Walters and Coach Peterson and a couple other older coaches who will be the mentors. And then I have a lot of young bucks that need to go out there and recruit. And that's what they need to do. So I'll turn them loose on this 2022 class and see where it goes.
Thanks, Coach.
Yep.
Okay, Bob Rosenthal and then Mark Pearson. Go ahead, Bob.
Hey, Coach, I'm curious about the unique opportunity you spoke of to where Illinois high schools are playing this spring, junior college is playing in the spring. With any of those spots you have left, how do you plan to attack that?
That's a great question, Bob. So, like, to be quite obvious, we're just going to sit and watch and observe. We can't go out on the road right now by NCAA rules, so it's kind of everything is continuing to work in our favor, right? If none of us can go out, then it makes the playing field pretty level. And to be in the state here and to be able to build a relationship, that's why we divided the state up into 10 different segments, and our coaches will begin to contact these coaches now and just say, hey, is there anybody that's popping up? Anybody that we're seeing? Maybe that, you know, sometimes those coaches don't even know that someone's becoming a Division I prospect right in front of their face. So you got guys that may come out. I've signed guys that have never played football till their senior year, or guys that, you know, have come out for the first time that all of a sudden they're a Division I prospect. So we'll burn the phone lines. And then when film's available, we'll begin to do everything we can there. I think a lot of teams in our division, especially in our conference, probably have tapped out, you know, and been able to maximize all their scholarships. That's kind of what the first urge is, but we've got a lot left. I don't want to sign one that I don't want. And we don't want to sign one that maybe we didn't do our due diligence on. We want to be thorough and detailed and build everything up. So we'll just do a lot of research and evaluation over the next, you know, 2 months, to be quite honest, Bob, and rely on word of mouth, but also word of mouth from our coaches in the state.
And then how would that same thing affect your 2022 recruiting, such as, you know, some states played 4 football games this fall and some, you know, didn't have playoffs, and, you know, it's not the same film that you would normally have for a bunch of juniors going into their senior year. So how does that change your approach?
Well, it's actually better, right? So, I mean, guys are now getting junior film that's further down their career. So they would have normally finished up their junior season in December. Now they're going to be finishing up in April, you know, May. And that to me is a distinct advantage because young men develop a lot between the ages of 16 and 18, you know, the more time they have on this earth. So it'll actually be a helpful tool for us, or at least if we perceive it that way, because now you have later film on them. I distinctly remember watching some film and you're like, it's junior film, but you're like, well, this is November of their junior year. Well, heck, now it's going to be March and April of their junior year, you know? So it's even better evaluation physically of what they may be.
Thanks.
Hey, Mark Pearson, you're up. Matt Stevens on deck.
Hey, Coach, hope all is well. What are kind of the difficulties with mixing a previous tenure's class with your class and kind of having to mix them together?
Good question, Mark. I think first, we needed to get an evaluation. So when we got in here as a staff, as I began to hire coaches, one of the first things we did is evaluated our signees, right? The signee class that we had in place before we got here, just to see where they're at. So we had an understanding of where we needed to go forward. Bart Miller did a thorough evaluation of the offensive linemen. He already knew a lot of them through recruiting this area. So there's a lot of carryover. Same thing with Terrence Jameson. He already knew a lot of the recruits from recruiting and being in the area with Purdue. So there was a lot of carryover that made it easy. But then also after we had that evaluation of the recruiting class to move into our ongoing evaluation of our current roster to find out exactly where we at, where we need holes. I think the whole grad transfer thing is a thing that I've been intrigued with for a long time. Here's what you get when you get a grad transfer, right? High school kids are heavily affected by 50 years of football that they didn't even be a part of. So when you get a young man who's 17, 18 years old, he's been hearing from his dad, his uncle, his brother, his coach about, you know, these different programs that have 50 years of winning tradition and high level success, you know, winning Big Ten championships, national championships, all this information that really isn't relevant of what's going on today. I mean, yes, they can continue to be good, or maybe they're not going to be as good. So it really, I really became aware and cognizant of that when I was at Wisconsin, when we were going to restructure the conference, and they laid out a 20 year history of conference football. And, you know, especially in our division that we are now, there were certain schools that maybe weren't viewed as perennial powers, but over the last 20 years, they had more success than some of those that were viewed in that way that had national championships. So it's hard to erase 50, 75 years of history. All right. But what a grad transfer does, or someone who's matured in the process, they now make effectively educational and business decisions, right? They're going to make decisions knowing they're on a shorter window of time. They've already seen the glamour and glitz and the buzz and maybe all the glitter. Now they want the meat and potatoes, what makes them great. And, you know, we have some overriding principles that once you get into our building, people are going to be able to speak to. I'll be able to point to people of success and let them understand, hey, this isn't about the glitter. This is about the results. And hopefully that'll help us.
Thanks, Coach. Appreciate it.
Hey, Matt Stevens, you're up. Billy Wagner on deck.
Brett, I wanted to ducktail off that question and ask you, you've talked about it in previous Zooms with us, but how important was it for you to wrap your arms around the November signees, let them know that they're welcome, we want to do great things with them? And specifically, I'm thinking about a kid like Brody Weiscarver, who probably could have asked for his release and got recruited by a whole bunch of Power Five schools, but has really been embracing and really excited about the opportunity to play for you and your staff.
Matt, I appreciate the question. Here's what I would tell you. I'm a guy that really doesn't believe in putting an unneeded agenda on anybody. Those players were here in our program. They existed already. Excited to have them in. What their story was to get here or however they arrived really has no bearing to me. I just know they're all part of the Illini family now. So, you know, every player gets an opportunity to come in here and do what they do. They're going to be given every opportunity to be successful. And I think a lot of them will take advantage of it. They obviously recruited into a system or a scheme that was existing before I came here. So how they fit into it or how they adapt relies greatly on us as coaches to play to their strengths and minimize their weaknesses, but also is a different picture for them. So we definitely have had a conversation with all of them about where we are, how excited we are. And now the true test will come once they hit campus to see where we're at and where we're moving forward.
And I wanted to ask you about Josh McCray. Our SI guys were really intrigued about you being able to get somebody that late that's that talented and that athletic. What sets him apart from guys maybe you've recruited in the past at running back, because you've had a pretty impressive group wherever you've been, but it just seems like Josh has unique talents.
He does, you know, and again, I give a lot of credit to, I think in life, as you go through it, you're rewarded so many times for things that you had no idea that you were positioning yourself for later. You know what I mean? The relationship I had with Coach Kennedy when he was a high school coach in Wisconsin, and he went and coached in Florida. Now he's coaching Alabama. I just stayed in touch with him. When I was in coaching, when I was in the NFL, he's just an intriguing coach to me that really always cared for his players. The way he handled Melvin's situation and helped us get through it, and then obviously helped mold him into the player he was today. Just to stay true to that, little did I know I was ever going to be the head coach at the University of Illinois. Did I know that I was going to get a job late in December? Did I know that he was going to have a running back that was sitting there ready to be captivated and cultured? It just all played out. I really do think everything happens for a reason, and that was a huge factor into it. If I didn't know who Jed Kennedy was, I had over 1,400 messages on my phone those first 2 days. But I knew when he reached out to me and said he had a player, I knew I needed to call him. And then Coach Jones, his running back coach there at his high school, talked to his family and just began to build that trust. There were schools that were reaching out to him, and we just kind of instantly identified with him. He began to see what our history was as running back, and I was kind of a one man band at the time. You know, I was playing a little bit of snare drum, tambourine, and tuba all at the same time to get him in a position to be here. And he just kind of stayed the course. And then here as of late, some people came in swarming on him, and he stayed true again. So just all the stars aligned correctly. And I'm very excited about his talent.
Thanks, Brad. Have a good one.
Thank you, man.
Hey, Joey Wagner, you're up, and then Colin on deck.
Hey, Brett, you talked about transfers, but how does the advent of the transfer portal, how does that streamline the whole process and get things going maybe quicker or more efficiently?
Joey, you know what it is? It's a work in progress, to be honest. So one of the things that Pat and I and the staff is doing currently is setting up our personnel and our recruiting departments now as we speak. And being last year into 3 years in the NFL has really taught me a valuable kind of assumption that we're going to carry forward here. You know, high school football is and high school recruiting and college football and college recruiting has changed so much because of the transfer portal that we now actually will have a branch and Pat will kind of oversee everything, but I'll have a personnel department that'll have a college personnel director and a high school personnel director. Much like in the NFL, you have an NFL personnel and then you have college personnel. You have players that are being evaluated coming out of the college ranks for the draft and free agency. And then you have a group of people on your in the NFL that work strictly on NFL rosters about potential trades, free agencies, et cetera. So we'll do kind of the same thing. We'll have a traditional high school college personnel director that works on college, high school film coast to coast, everywhere in between, and especially the state of Illinois. And then I'll have a college personnel director that will also be an NFL liaison that will work specifically on, you know, college transfer, grad transfer, regular traditional JUCOs, and then also obviously portal transfers that you get now because of the rule that exists. I just think it's kind of wiser, smarter. It's a part of the world. And again, getting back to that point of recruiting, sometimes high school players are going to be heavily influenced and can't make great decisions just based on a lot of hype around certain schools because they've been around doing things for longer than we have. All right. Well, for us to gain a competitive advantage here at Illinois, I think we got to look at every advantage we can with someone that needs to be in this program that wants to win now.
And is that breaking it up, is that something that you just kind of picked up from your time seeing how it did in the NFL with breaking it into two different departments? Did you lean on anybody who said, hey, maybe this has worked for us? How did you come to that decision?
Well, it's kind of a couple different things happened, right? So I've been in college football for a long time. Then I was removed, but then for 3 years, basically 2 years with New England, I was able to travel from coast to coast and work out these prospects on their campuses. So no longer was I Bret Bielema, the head coach at a Division I program, coming in and looking at their prospects. I was a visiting NFL assistant coach who was evaluating their prospects. And all of a sudden I was a lot more friendly to the head coaches that were in that building. They allowed me to come in. I began to see things up close and personal. I saw how they laid out their personnel. I saw how they laid out their departments. I saw how they recruited different strategies. And we'll kind of a blend that all together. And then, of course, I was heavily involved in NFL personnel. Even the last year with the Giants, getting in with Joe on the grassroots level, going through that draft process. And I was in charge of player development. I worked with a couple other people that worked on building that bridge with new people in the building, right? So people that were the Giants in the past, but new blood that we brought in and blending them together. So there's a lot of different factors that key into it. But I would say it's going back really just on a wealth of knowledge of being at several other spots and figuring out what went well and what didn't went well. We'll be unique. We'll have a pro style approach to personnel. And the fact that one of the things the NFL loves to do is compare players to each other. So you may have, what is this player? Is he similar to this NFL player? We'll do the same thing in high school. We'll recruit Johnny B. Good out of high school and compare him to Johnny B. Great here at our campus or another campus and show him the likeness that he has that blends right into the new rules that come into effect with imaging, likeness, and branding. That's another guy that I hired that you'll meet next week that is going to be a new arm of our recruiting tool that will really be branding, identity, and also social media that will start in their high school recruitment, continue during their development here on our roster, and then into the NFL as well.
Thanks, Brett. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Hey, Colin, you're up. Jeremy Warner on deck.
Hey, Brett. I don't know if you really set expectations for recruiting off the bat. Obviously, you have a lot of things to deal with initially being hired. But considering how this first month has gone, you add two guys to the class of 2021, several transfers have announced their commitments here. Has this kind of exceeded your expectations, how well things have kind of gone here for recruiting so far? And how have you just felt about the way the process has gone for the first month plus?
I've been very excited. You know, I told Josh when we started to get serious and when I realized I was going to take this opportunity that we have to turn this time in our lives, what a lot of people are classifying as, you know, a very trying times in our life. And it is, like, you know, I have two parents in their 80s. You know, I understand COVID and I understand the seriousness of it and what it brings. And because of that, the number one priority is safety and health, right? But because of that, there's a set of rules that we're playing under. I always say this to our coaches, our players, hey, just tell me the rules and we can play. Let me know the rules and we can go out and do what we do. And I just try to maximize every angle that I could think of and be a part of, and really get to where we are right now. I am excited. I think we've brought some new blood in, but also recruited blood that was in our program to stay here. I'm not going to sit here and tell you that I wasn't excited to get some of those seniors that could have walked out the door, could have either went to the NFL or a different opportunity, and they stayed here and decided to be a part of it. And we're still working that angle. We're still trying to recruit some people back into this building. And I just think it's important for us to realize, you know, three things. It really doesn't matter what's happened in the past. All we can do is worry about what we're doing today. And today is greatly going to affect tomorrow. If we just stay down that road, we just keep stacking days. Whatever happens, happens. If you're better today than you were tomorrow or than you were yesterday, we're going to be in a good situation. I didn't know my staff was going to play out as well as it did. I had an idea and a concept, but because of the momentum we gained, I was able to bring some people aboard at the end. And because of the support Josh and administration gave us, we were able to bring some people aboard that I didn't expect to get on board. And we're just going to keep riding that wave. I realize it's a little bit of a honeymoon phase, right? I get it. We're undefeated. Everybody's happy. But, you know, for the most part, we just got to keep being our same person and see where tomorrow brings us.
And I know we've spoken a bit about Josh McCray. Can you speak a little bit also about Dwayne Johnson? Obviously, everybody likes the name, but beyond that, what you feel he brings to the field and just, what he can bring to that linebacker room.
You know what I like? I like excitement, and DJ is excited. For the first time we talked to him, to where I called him this morning, you'll get some footage released later today that we were able to give him a little bit of surprise here in the building. And he's just a fun kid. He's exciting. He's raw. I don't think he has any idea how good he can be. He's really long, rangy, athletic. He's got power. He makes a lot of plays in the kicking game. He's got ability. I think the word value is going to mean a lot to us. Like, one thing you'll learn, or I learned in the NFL, is the more positions you can play effectively, the better value you bring. And we'll do that same thing here in our program. He can play a little bit of outside backer, a little defensive end, a little maybe even off the ball backer. He can play a lot in the kicking game. You know, tough teams do three things. They stop the run, they can run the football, and they cover kicks, all right? Josh McCary is going to run the football, and Dwayne Johnson is going to stop the run, and both of them will cover kicks. So as long as we keep bringing people into our program that can do those things, we'll have good results.
Thanks, Brett.
Thank you.
Hey, Jeremy, you're up, and then Greg Palermo on deck.
Hey, Brett, hope you're well. I know you guys have been busy with the 2022 class since you got here. How have you kind of tried to, you know, chew at that with you know, obviously you guys have to spend a lot of offers and do a lot of evaluation. What's been the goal for you guys for 2022, the first month on the job?
You know, Jeremy, it's a great point. And then they changed the rule, you know, just like 3 days ago when they opened up the allotment of, you have unlimited phone calls to the class of 2022 now. So that really spun it into a whole different direction we were on already. You know, before you'd have to get them to reply back to you or get the coach to Orion a phone call, but you could text them, but you couldn't just call them direct. So literally I sit down every day with a group of players in front of me, whether it be 10 to 20 players. And I'm a big believer in recruiting the parents, the coaches, the assistant coaches, you know, whoever is going to help make that decision, whoever helped make them who they are, we want to touch base with them. So it's a daily agenda. It's a daily grind. Yesterday I was talking to a certain prospect in a certain state and learned that, you know, since I had met with my staff earlier in the day, they had already talked to another prospect at the same school and they were doing a Zoom call that night. So like, it literally changes right in front of you. But it's fun. It's engaging. It's an exciting time in our program. I think there's a lot of juice around the place, you know, just everybody's a little bit excited and that's not going to change. I mean, we're going to bring daily excitement. I brought in 10 coaches who, you know, we basically have our morning set up where we're working on football. So you'll hear in the morning, we'll get in here. Our guys are getting swabbed 5:30, 6 o'clock in the morning. We'll settle in and work on football until about noon. And then in the afternoon until the late evening, I think we got out of here last night. We had our last Zoom at 7 o'clock, usually those last hour, hour and a half. And all my coaches are involved in those calls. And it's just a daily grind, but it's a grind that I think will be worth it in the end.
Speaking of the grind, you know, not being able to go out on the road, I would imagine with the juice you're talking about, you'd love to get your guys in high schools. What's the challenge of that, or how are you kind of attacking that?
Yeah, so great question. So, you know, we've kind of now gotten word that the NCAA might be leaning, not leaning towards, you know, getting back out on the road for them to at least come see us. But I don't see us getting out anytime soon. So we will begin to Zoom call those, you know, we've laid out our recruiting areas. Those will get handed to our coaches literally within the next 2 days. Pat and I put together a plan, not just into the state, but also across the country. And if we can't go there, we're going to Zoom there, right? Sounds like it's almost illegal, right? But we'll go there and put ourselves in a position to meet with those coaches, meet with assistant coaches. If they can get the players on the phone, anything we can do to outreach those places, we'll do and engage them and bring them in. And, you know, again, I've said this a couple times, there's nothing better right now than a Zoom call. You know, you could have a kid that's in, you know, a kid that's in St. Louis, who's got grandparents that are in another state, that he's got an uncle that's in another state, and he's got a brother that's in college at another state. He's got a sister that's at another place. You got an uncle that's been involved in him. You got a coach that is at his second job and he's sitting in a different house. We've had, you know, 8, 10, 12 people on these Zoom calls that are all in the same visit, walking through our facility, walking through the Smith Center. You know, the things that were built before I came here, the Smith Center, and all the people that have given financial support during some of the tougher times here is just truly beginning to reward and pay off for us. And all we got to do is just keep maximizing that and see where it goes.
And sorry, I just had one more. You've mentioned Pat Umbleton a few times and Corey Patterson. What have those two meant to your recruiting? And what have they added for you right away?
Game changers. Pat is, I could tell right away when I first met him. A, he loves his job. B, he loves the University of Illinois. He's been here 9 years. I don't know how he does it. He's got a wife that's an absolute saint. She's carrying around a 2.5-year-old and another one that's, I believe, right about 1.5, and they got 11 months, I think, and they got another one on the way. And so they're gonna have 3 under 3. I think I got nuts. He's got a whole nother level of nutness. But like he's truly been, you know, so well versed in our campus. Knows all the right people to contact. He's an Ohio guy. Kind of got annoying during the whole Cleveland Browns thing, but that's a whole nother conversation. But I think the great thing was it was easy to see he cares about this place. He cares about what's going on, and was able to kind of see early on and have given him more value, gave him a promotion, gave a nice bump, and he's really been a rock star. And then Corey, kind of completely opposite of that, you know, so I just learned this in the past, right? So there's a lot of times when head coaches come in and dismiss an entire staff, don't even meet with them. I remember being a part of a couple transitions myself, or hearing about them where coaches, you know, either dismiss them without meeting the coaches, or got literally everybody lined up in 5-minute interviews and just kind of running them through and kicking them out. I sat down, told the coaches, hey, we're going to meet tomorrow. I gave them a meeting schedule. We slotted off a half hour for everybody to roll themselves through. And I wanted to get to know them. I wanted to hear from them. I wanted to know, you know, what they wanted to tell me. I knew that I would get smarter at the end of the day if I listened to those 10 of coaches tell me things. And CP would be the first to tell you, I pulled up his resume the night before, and his headshot on his bio sheet on the computer was not, let's say, CP's a good looking dude, but he had this mean face on. There's no smile, no nothing. And I'm like, what's this grumpy bear all about? Like, I'm literally like, can't wait to see what he's all about. And then I pop in his meeting and he's like, you know, when he pops that mask off and he's smiling ear to ear. And like, I sit down, I visit with him, and I'm like, I totally did not expect to keep him. I didn't think there was, you know, the guy only been here a couple of years, high school coach, but you just felt his energy. You just felt his excitement. You know, now obviously he'll be coaching running backs, but he kicked tail on the board on the interview process. He just wanted to be a part of it. I didn't give him a job. I told him, you've earned the right to interview. When I brought in Coach Peterson and Coach Miller, might have been one or two other coaches, we sat down and interviewed him and just saw how much he's engaged. And then when I made a decision to offer him an opportunity to be here, he's just been a rock star. And he doesn't just do the players he knows. All of a sudden, I'll be talking to a defensive player, and he's reached out to them. I'll be talking to a defensive player currently on our roster, and he's talked to them. He's got a very engaging personality, and we're truly blessed to have him, and I want to have him for a long time because he's going to be a shooting star in his profession.
Thanks so much, Brett.
Yep.
All right, Greg, you're up, and then Jim Cotter after that. Go ahead, Greg.
Yeah. Hey, Coach. Following up on the 2022 question, talk a little bit, if you can, about how the process is changed since you were at Arkansas, as far as, you know, kids now in the 2022 class that already have verbals. What do you think the percentages were back in your last year at Arkansas, as far as the following year already having verbal commits on the previous national signing day?
Yeah, it's a great point. It's changed dramatically in my 3 years away, there's no doubt. But I still think the recruiting business is a people business. You know, you got to learn what the trigger points are. You got to learn what they want. I do think the thing that gets frustrating is there are kids that maybe they felt they have made a decision, but the right away, the first thing they'll tell you, like, I don't care who they're committed to or what they have said. All I do is give them a chance to know that I'm interested. The University of Illinois is going to recruit them. And if they want that, that's what we'll do. And a lot of them right away immediately, oh, coach, I put out a top four. That's not my top four anymore. Or, coach, I made a commitment. That was just, you know, I always tell them this, right? A computer only knows what it's been programmed to do. Like I'm the least technology savvy person you'll ever meet, right? I don't get it, right? But I do know this. If you ask a computer a question that it doesn't know or it hasn't been programmed, it can't answer. And as human beings, we're the exact same thing. I always tell them, hey, all we've done is given you new information to the computer. You made a decision. Hey, congratulations. Great. But if you allow new information to come in, you may get a new answer. And it's an oversimplistic way of saying it, but it's the way it makes sense to me. And I think a lot of people buy into it. So we're just going to keep giving new information. If someone says no, then we can say thank you and move on. But until then, we're going to go full go after anybody that we want. And we'll see what happens.
And lastly, since you're obviously more into the portal than some other programs are, how are you evaluating players who opted out of 2020? Given your NFL experience, the Giants had some players on defense that opted out. I know in basketball, there's talk of teams opting out of their conference tournaments. They opted out for a reason, but it now kind of seems like it's getting flipped back on folks. How do you evaluate players who opted out?
You know, it's a decision they made again that I wasn't a part of. You know, some of them are health related. Some of them were choices that maybe their family made for them. It was a different time back then. Just think how much information we have now compared to what we had back then. I mean, they made a decision based off the information they had. They made the decision was best for them. That's them. I wasn't a part of it. I don't have a factor in it, but what we can do is work this going forward. Now there are kids and there's different layers of it. As you know, Greg, like there's guys that maybe opted out, but then also went in the transfer portal, which is totally different. If a kid just opted out, that's a different deal. Or if he just went into portal, there's all kinds of rules that apply to it. So each case has to be evaluated basically on that same scenario. Each case is its own unique story.
Thanks, Brett.
Yeah, thank you.
All right, Jim Cotter, you're up. And then that may be the last one in line right now. So go ahead. Nope, Joey said. Go ahead, Jim.
Hey, Brett, I wanted to circle back a minute to the talking about, you know, talking to players over Zoom. I know, do you sometimes not get the feel of that personal of a connection that you would if you would talk to somebody in person? I know times being as they are, that's the only way to do it right now. But do you feel still the personal connection when you talk to somebody via Zoom than what you would face-to-face?
I do, Jim, but I think it's just also based on person. Like, I'm going to be honest, like we had a roster of 90 players when I was with the Giants, right? And I had a group of outside linebackers that I was engaged with. Some of you guys might remember Wale Batiku, right? He was a player that was here. It took me all about 30 seconds to realize what a personality I had there, right? I mean, it was, he pretty much came through the screen, right? So it's easier for certain people to do that and their personality came out versus, you know, guys that are a little bit more reserved. Maybe they're not great communicating. So one of the first things we do when we're in Zoom calls, I make all the rooks or the freshmen, they got to tell a joke. And I mean, they're bad, bad jokes, but where we're at from day one to where we are yesterday, I mean, you know, Dylan was reading them off his screen. I could see he had jokes.com open. All right. And the delivery was awful, but it was better than it was the other day. So we're just trying to get him to engage and talk and communicate. And that's just part of my process to make them be that way. But for me, as you can tell, right, it's not hard for me to communicate. I'm probably better in a Zoom environment than I was 10 years ago or, you know, 15 years ago. Definitely when I was 18, I'm a heck of a lot better, but that's just growth and maturity. So it's our job as coaches to bring it out. When we do these Zoom interviews, we're very interactive. The camera's moving, not crazy, right? We don't want bouncing, getting people sick, but we move from one room to another room, to a different host, to a different person. And you keep it moving and spinning and it makes it about as good as you can. I'm sure there's advantage to being in person, but I'm telling you, there's advantages to being Zoom as well. And if you don't think of it that way, you'll never get to be that way. So it's all about your perception as well.
Yeah, thanks, Brad. Appreciate it.
We'll go with John Supini and then finish up with Joey Wagner if there's time. Go ahead, John.
Hey, Coach, can you just speak to the opportunity you have this year to kind of get this thing going with, like you said, you got the opportunity to do the super seniors, the transfer portal. Did this give you a chance to kind of get this thing going quicker than maybe in past years?
Well, John, I appreciate it. And you know, the intention is to be good as fast as we can, but I also don't want to skip a step to get to where we want to be. I tell kids all the time, man, like, how many of us have ever found the gold at the end of the rainbow, right? It doesn't exist. It's a myth. It's because we can't get there, right? Don't try to jump to the end, all right? Read the book. Chapter by chapter, enjoy the process, right? So the process we had was we had to recruit our seniors back. We got back into fall or into spring session here. We're about 10 days into it. It's been a lot of fun. There's a lot of growth. There's a lot of things to improve. We haven't really begun. I do some football one-on-one. Yesterday we went through a four-point play. Some of them have never heard of that before. We do football one-on-one at the end, do some different things that's new to them, but in keeping them engaged, I'm telling you, they're discovering new muscles and tendons and parts of their body they didn't even have existed before. Tank's pointing out to him and his crew. So there's a lot of really neat things developing with our crew. And we're excited about the challenge, but as far as like where it is, I have no idea. You know, I joke about it all the time. We're all undefeated right now, right? But our schedule is going to be coming out soon. We got an opportunity to look at that and view that, see where we're at, but we're just competing against ourselves every day. We're going to have one mission every day, right, that we kind of stress is we just want to keep stacking days, keep putting days on top of one another. If we're better this Saturday than we were last Saturday, we're making progress. And that's the only thing I know how to do right now.
And, Coach, I'm not trying to be too stereotypical, but you look like a tuba guy to me in that one-man band.
No stereotype taken. I did start at the cornet, and I think as I – got larger in life, I kept getting a bigger instrument. But my band instructor was an assistant football coach. So I think he was motivated by size as well.
Thanks, Coach.
Yep.
And this will be the last question. Joey Wagner, to wrap it up. Go ahead, Joey.
Britt, I wanted to follow up. How has social media impacted recruiting, whether it be what the NCAA allows you guys to do or just the impact that a post can have on a fan base?
Joey, unfortunately, that's probably one of the biggest factors, but it's part of the reason I designed our recruiting department the way we have, you know, to be quite honest. You know, we obviously had some guys here working on graphics as it is, but to bring in Patrick Pearson and a guy that's been in this business a long time and will work with imaging and licensing and branding that will work in our recruiting department, he's been in the communication field a long time, both with me at Arkansas. He recently came from Oregon. And the part that's fun is he looks at this opportunity in a totally different perspective than we have as coaches. He's never been in a football office. So he's bringing in some thoughts and ideas that are going to really be crucial, I think, as we move into this new world. Like even today, some of the stuff we did with recruiting was just really great thoughts by him. We're going to make some well wishes to some guys involved in the Super Bowl here that was really some imaging and thought process that he did. So we got some guys thinking outside the box. You know, I think as a head coach, the more you can surround yourself with people that aren't like you, you get better. That's one thing I've learned now in my third stop. And the power of social media is unbelievable. The first thing I get off the phone when I get done offering a young man or as high school coach, I get off the phone, I usually send them a graphic that they can use in the social media world to post. And you know, and then we'll get specific. I remember Josh, one of Josh's first ones, what he wanted, he likes to weld. So I gave him a graphic with him welding. And that was like, Coach, this is awesome. I'm like, like we got a kid welding. That's real rocket scientist there, but it was just something that meant something to him, and he loved it. And it kind of wheeled into a nice spin that got us to where we are today. So yeah, we'll use it all the way through and continue to use it, hopefully on the cutting edge.
Thanks, Brett. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right, Coach. Thank you. That wraps up today. Appreciate everybody's attendance and participation. So thank
you. I think we as a group appreciate your background. That is one really, really live background. I think Mark Pearson here with this little ensemble he has behind him here, it's perfectly mapped out. Those are probably some.
That's my wife. Junior. My wife did all that. So
I got you. I was looking for a participation ribbon.
There you go. Thanks, Coach.
All right, fellas.